introduce Carlo Barenghi, who is coming from Newcastle University. He's going to talk to us about cold things, very cold things, including turbulence.
Okay, thank you very much. Good morning to everybody. So, today I would like to tell you about a story which brings together three strands: the idea of quantum, the idea of cold, and then what you are more familiar with, which is turbulence. So the topic is quantum turbulence, which is a subfield of condensed matter physics, atomic physics, and fluid dynamics, hopefully, and perhaps astrophysics. So first of all, cold. What is cold? Well, since we are going to see fluids near absolute zero, it's interesting actually to remind you when the idea of absolute zero was first conceived. It was a French instrument maker called Amonton who in the late 1600s thought of measuring the pressure changes induced by temperature changes in a gas. And he found that he could fit his data extrapolating to a point at which pressure would become zero. He thought that could not be negative. And amazingly, he extrapolated to -240 Celsius on our current scale of temperature. Now, more or less at the same time, the Swiss mathematician Bernoulli was thinking about fluids, and he believed in atoms. That was not trivial at the time. And he thought that essentially absolute zero would correspond to no motion at all. So these were actually very good ideas, but unfortunately, they were held back for many decades when the great scientist Lavoisier sort of developed the idea of caloric. And that put this kind of science astray for a while. But the ideas of Amontons and Bernoulli came back in the mid 19th century, 1800s, and as the science of thermodynamics was developed. So now we know about temperature scales, precise temperature scales. So we don't use, well, some people still insist in using the Fahrenheit temperature scale, where the 0 and the 100 were defined rather arbitrarily. The Celsius scale, invented by a Swedish scientist, Celsius, actually originally was the other way around. So the boiling point of water was 0. It was actually the great botanist Linnaeus, who was a senior professor at Uppsala University, who told him, don't be silly, just do it the other way. But hereafter, I shall use the Kelvin degree scale. So it's the same size of degree as the Celsius scale, but we start at absolute zero. So, as I said, in the second half of the 1800s, physicists starting worrying about liquefying gases, because so they knew that in going from a gas to a liquid to a solid, then they would actually lower and lower the temperature, and it was quite clear that it was important to lower the temperature because thermal disorder essentially hides the fundamental properties of matter. So actually reducing the temperature, new things become, important things become visible. So there was a sort of race to liquefy gases, starting from Faraday, who was one of the first, continuing to famous scientists like James Dewar, who is nowadays basically forgotten. He made liquid hydrogen first, and the still low temperature physicist called Dewar, essentially a thermal bottle to contain a liquid, which is cold. So this is the table in which you see this progress, this race towards lower and lower temperatures. So we start from room temperature, which is about 300 Kelvin, and soon we go too cold to standard. For example, 77 Kelvin is where nitrogen, which is the most important component of air, becomes liquid. And if you lower another 10, 15 degrees, then air becomes, nitrogen becomes solid, and so does oxygen. And then at about 20, hydrogen goes liquid, and then solid. James Dewar at his time was famous because he made liquid hydrogen. He thought he had reached the ultimate cold, but it was not so, because in his department, the London Institution, there was somebody called Ramsey who had discovered helium, and they were not very friendly with each other, by the way, so that did not help James Dewar. So he had actually to try then to make helium liquid, and that proved to be quite difficult because because things get harder and harder technically as the temperature is lower. So he succeeded, but he was not the first. He was beaten on this race by a Dutch Kamerling Onnes in Leiden, who was the first to liquefy helium at 4.2 Kelvin in 1908. Now, Onnes was also the first who discovered an amazing phenomenon, superconductivity, with mercury, which is about the same temperature. And then the rest of the list is full of Nobel Prizes. So this idea that as you lower the temperature, you get more fundamental physics still holds true. Now, I want to point out that the cosmic background radiation is actually about 3 Kelvin. So the low temperature physicists in this room actually do very cool stuff, because actually they are making something which is rather unique in the universe, or perhaps anticipates the future as the universe cools down. So we have other milestones. For example, the liquid helium-3, which is the rare, expensive isotope of helium. Helium is like an alpha particle, two protons, two neutrons. Helium-3 has only one neutron. Becomes liquid and superfluid at this temperature at around millikelvin. And then we have finally Bose-Einstein condensation in cold gases at macrokelvin level. So the second strand is quantum mechanics. I don't really need going to say much about quantum mechanics. I just want to remind you that from basic undergraduate courses, there is one thing which perhaps you remember, that quantum mechanics deals with very tiny, small microscopic objects like electrons, atoms, quarks. And the other idea is that there is some particle wave duality. So the motion of matter, the motion of particles can also be seen as the motion of waves, and we had a sort of many paradoxical results which are very famous. So let's start from this point indeed. So if we have an atom with a mass m and velocity v, it has a momentum p, which is mv, and we know that we can associate to this atom a wave, which is called the De Broglie wavelength, the thermal De Broglie wavelength, which is this, lambda. We also know from thermodynamics that we have a gas in equilibrium, the average kinetic energy of an atom would be proportional to kT, where k is Boltzmann constant. So if you put these two informations together, you find that the De Broglie wavelength goes like t to the minus 1/2. And then a very simple question, but a really deep question arises. What happens if we reduce the temperature and we let it go to zero? Now, this question is particularly relevant for bosons. You know that all particles are essentially divided into two classes, fermions and bosons. So depending on the spin, the bosons have integer spins, the fermions have integer spins. Now, the fermions obey Pauli's principle. So if we consider the way you can arrange them on energy levels, for example, suppose you have some kind of trap, you need to stack them high up, because they don't like to stay together, essentially. So you end up with filling your levels up to some Fermi level. Bosons, however, don't obey Pauli's principle. They obey different statistics, indeed, and they have no problem in actually collapsing down to the lowest available state, the ground state. And it is this idea which motivated a young Indian student called Bose in the 20s, who then decided to write to Einstein, who was very famous in the 20s. Then they started a collaboration, and they discovered what is now called Bose-Einstein condensation, which is this effect, essentially the occupation of the ground state by all the particles. So how does it work? Well, I think the best way to explain it in a simple fashion is this. Consider a gas of bosons. So any kind of atom, but make sure it's bosons. And compare the de Broglie wavelength lambda against the typical separation, the average distance between the atoms in your gas. So as I said, as the temperature decreases, lambda increases. So this wave, the de Broglie wavelength, which is actually normally very, very short, becomes noticeable. At some point, it will become of the same order as the separation between the atoms. So these quantum mechanical waves will start overlapping and eventually creating some kind of gigantic wave. And it is indeed at the point where, for the gas of bosons, lambda becomes of the same order of magnitude as d, that we have Bose-Einstein condensation. So at that point, your gas is not really a gas of n particles, but you should think of that as a single quantum object which is ruled by macroscopic wave function. So I stress macroscopic. So your psi does not describe a tiny little thing like an electron, but perhaps hundreds of liters of liquid helium. Now, this idea of Bose-Einstein condensation actually applies to various systems. Perhaps the most one of the most important is superconductivity. And the second kind of phenomenon which follows is superfluidity. The two things are similar. In superconductors, we have flow of currents without electrical resistance. In superfluids, we have flows without viscosity. So we have, in particular, the superfluidity of liquid helium 4, the standard helium, which is used to make balloons for parties, for example. Helium 3, too expensive for that. And also the cold atomic gases. Now, the cold atomic gases really achieve Bose-Einstein condensation almost in the ideal situation conceived by Bose and Einstein, which was the scenario of an ideal gas. And everything which I'm going to say afterwards will refer essentially to helium and cold gases, because nowadays there are more superfluids. So first of all, for example, neutron stars. Now, neutron stars, unfortunately, you cannot do experiment with, but we can observe them. And there are many, there are more than 2,000. They are not actually, you may think they are not cold. If you look at the temperature scale, the Kelvin scale of temperature, they're actually very cold if you compare that temperature against what is actually a critical temperature, the temperature of Bose-Einstein condensation, or Fermi temperature. And then there are polaritons, for example, which are essentially Bose-Einstein condensate made of light coupled to excitons, and the magnons, etc. So I limit myself to helium and cold gases because we have more evidence, because what interests me is, in this context, is vortices and turbulence. So we know more. Another bit of information. Well, I said at the critical temperature, TC, we have this condensation, essentially a phase transition a phase transition in momentum space, a phase transition which is driven not by the interactions, but it's driven by the statistics, yeah? Which is quite interesting. So if we go below this critical temperature, then as said, there is a finite fraction of the atoms which collapse onto the ground state. So you have this behavior, so the fraction of atoms in the ground state as a fraction of the total is this formula. Now, there is a difference between the cold gases and the liquid helium. Liquid helium is liquid, so the atoms interact much more strongly. But anyhow, you can compare this behavior, this curve, to the similar curve for the superfluid fraction, the superfluid component of liquid helium, as it is called, starting from TC, where it is zero, and then it grows and becomes 100% at absolute zero. They are very similar curves. So in the case of liquid helium, in the 40s, a quite convenient mathematical description was put together by Landau and also independently by Tissa, called the two-fluid model. So now, what is the difference between the helium and the cold gases. I stress, the cold gases are very dilute, they are ballistic really, and the liquid helium is actually a liquid. So the mean free path is very short. So we can really talk about the fluid in a classical sense. And in the case of helium, indeed, Landau distinguished between these two fluid components, the normal fluid and the superfluid component. So each component comes with its own velocity field, Vn and Vs for normal and super, density field, rho n and rho s, so that the total amount of mass per volume is rho, is the sum of the two. And the crucial difference is that it's only the normal fluid which carries the entropy and the viscosity. The superfluid has no viscosity by definition and no entropy. If you think, entropy measures the number of the available states, and if you are on the ground state, the log of one is zero. Now, this model actually, which was developed by Landau and Tista, has quite important practical consequences revealed soon afterwards by experiments. For example, a very strange way of propagating sound called second sound, in which rather than having waves of density and pressure, what waves is temperature. And how does it happen? Well, the two fluids move in antiphase rather than in phase. So we have this extra degree of freedom. And in a sense associated to second sound, there is what is called thermal counterflow. And one of the lectures which will be given by Lamantia, I think tomorrow, will involve actually this. So let me remind you what it is. It's the basic way in which heat transfer takes place in liquid helium. So it's very important for engineering applications as a coolant. If you have a channel like this, which is blocked at one end, and dissipate heat at the left-hand side by means of some electrical resistor, this heat will be carried by the normal fluid, and the superfluid will flow to maintain essentially to guarantee conservation of mass. So you produce a counterflow of the two fluids, which means you can actually transport heat very, very well, ideally well, infinite thermal conductivity. So it's a very efficient mechanism. You can think of this as DC second sound. But what actually makes superfluidity interesting is not what I said, but the quantum vortices. So let me come to this point. So we have a single macroscopic wave function, psi. So it's a complex field. It has an amplitude and a phase. And if we apply some very standard quantum mechanical prescriptions, we can define a density and a velocity. So the density would be related to the amplitude of the wave function. And the velocity will be the gradient of the phase. So that means automatically that our condensate or our superfluid will have no vorticity because the curl of the gradient is equal to zero. That is what you may think. Indeed, it is correct, but there is a subtle difference here. It's possible, actually, to have circulation without vorticity. How does it happen? Well, let's consider the circulation integral. So we integrate the velocity around the closed loop, C. Now, this integral is either zero or something. When it is not zero, it must be a multiple, an integer multiple of this quantity, h, which is Planck's constant, divided by the mass of the boson you're dealing with. And k, this ratio is called the quantum of circulation kappa. So you have either zero or an integer number of quanta. So that happens, in this case, it happens because you are moving around a point at which psi is equal to zero. If psi becomes zero, then you cannot apply Stokes' theorem here because your region of integration becomes multiply connected. And you pick up the integration of the phase around. So psi equals zero is a point at which real part and imaginary part of psi are equal to zero, so the phase is not defined because you get zero divided by zero when you try to compute the argument of the arctangent. So you can think of a vortex as a topological defect, a point where the phase is not defined. So a point in two dimensions which becomes a line in space, a curve in space, in three dimensions. Now, I must add also that it turns out that vortices with many quanta, for most practical purposes, are unstable and break up. So it's energetically, but also dynamically, better to make many vortices carrying one quantum rather than one vortex with many quanta. So hereafter, I'll simply consider the quantum of circulation and talk about vortex lines with one quantum. Summarizing what I've said, this is a schematic diagram of a vortex, or a quantum vortex. So we have, if we take a cross-section along the one axis, for example, we have the density, which is constant in our system, in our cold gas or liquid helium, so the bulk value of the density. And then suddenly, the density goes to zero. It must be zero, exactly zero, at this point. And this behavior, actually, this sudden drop, takes place over some characteristic distance, which is called xi. It's often referred to as the healing length. Essentially, it's the size of the vortex core, the hollow region where there are no atoms on the axis. So corresponding to this, there is our phase defect. And here it is. So this is a plot. Essentially, the vortex is placed like this, in this diagram. So the phase goes between 0 and 2 pi as you move around. And corresponding to this changing phase, there is a velocity field. It's the velocity field around the vortex. And that velocity field has no way to escape this functional form. It must be 1 over r, or better, kappa, the quantum, divided by 2 pi r. So it's a classical vortex line, which you find in any elementary textbook of fluid dynamics. And as I said, there is no escape from this. You may ask, oh, well, what happens on the axis then? Because here, v seems to diverge. Indeed, it does. It goes to infinity on the axis, which is the topological defect. But notice that there is no problem, actually, because on the axis, also the density goes to zero. There are no atoms which move that fast. So everything remains very smooth and finite. So in summary, a quantum vortex is a tiny hole around which we have this quantized circulation, this phase which changes 2 pi. So it's a hole which is protected. You can think of that perhaps as a nonlinear wave, a very intense nonlinear wave, the most intense you can have, whose topology is protected by the circulation which is quantized. Now, just a word about cold gases. Unlike liquid helium, cold gases come in various kinds. Many have been tried, sometimes of the same element put in different states. And essentially, unlike liquid helium, we can actually play with the properties, even change them, something which atomic physicists are proud of. They can also change the dimensionality, which is nice. So these very dilute clouds of atoms can be shaped in any form by some externally applied potential, which essentially provides the confinement. So here I just made some sketches. So if you read the papers, you find often that the cloud of gas, this cold gas, is trapped in the shape of a cigar, for example, or a sphere, or some kind of flat disk. So the shape is really arbitrary. Now, what happens to the vortices in such shapes? Well, here is an example. So we have, for example, this kind of setup, or it could be any. So we have here in red the profile of the density along one axis, x. So you see that typically these cold gases are not homogeneous, because, and the reason is that in most experiments, the trapping potential is a very simple harmonic trap. So it's very strong in the middle and then becomes weaker, like x square. And so the density of the condensate inside is not uniform. So you have this profile. And the vortex is still a hole with circulation. So you see here a condensate with a vortex, which is slightly off-center, which is plotted here as a density profile. So now the vortex comes out to the board. It will be like this. So what you see here is a density profile. So the blue corresponds to zero density, so there is nothing there. Dark red is intense density, the maximum density in the middle. And you see the vortex. The vortex, as I said, is a hole. So there is a tiny blue spot, depletion, the depletion of the vortex core. And this vortex is there, and actually, it will actually orbit the condensate going around like this. And here is another three-dimensional picture of a single vortex put off-center in a condensate, which is somewhat, the shape is somewhat between this and that, some kind of flattened sphere. However, nowadays, there are techniques to produce atomic condensates which have uniform density. So the achievement was done in Cambridge. These systems essentially are called box-trapped condensates. A box trap is a trap which is not harmonic. Essentially, it is zero in a region, and then it's very steep. So you get a uniform density profile. And that is very nice, because it helps making a bridge between the standard case of cold gases and liquid helium, in which we are accustomed to thinking of uniform density. So there is, hopefully, there will be more experiments with box trap condensates. Now, vortices become evident if you try to rotate your superfluid or condensate. the prototype experiment was done a long time ago. So it's a cylinder filled, which is put in rotation. So can it rotate? Well, it depends. The normal fluid component, if the temperature is high enough, will rotate like water rotates, no difference. But what about the superfluid component? It cannot rotate, as I said, because it cannot have vorticity, but it can have defects with circulation. And so it will produce this kind of lattice, a regular lattice of vortex lines, as I sketched. And the number of vortices will be proportional to the rotation. According to this formula, which is often referred to as Feynman's formula, because it was Feynman who came up with this. So you see that here the number of vortices per unit area, which is this n, is twice the rotation rate, the angular frequency, divided by the quantum of circulation. In other words, the superfluid will try to make kappa times n vortices per unit area, mimicking the classical rotation, which is twice omega. So the faster you rotate, the more vortex lines. And that was beautifully seen for the first time in Berkeley, California, when this experiment was realized, in which the vortex lines were actually visualized using electrons. So these are essentially, these pictures are views of this rotating lattice from the top. So the single dot corresponds to a small rotation, just enough to create one vortex. And then we have two vortices. Then you increase the rotation, and nothing happens until you get 3 and 4 and 5, etc. And you create a vortex lattice. This is actually a picture taken at MIT. It's a Bose-Einstein condensate which rotates. And here you see about 100 vortices. So they appear dark, dark dots, points of zero density, like the zero density outside the condensate. And you see the shadow. You see it's brighter here and becomes more gray here. This is clearly a condensate which has been harmonically trapped. So the density is high in the middle and then decreases to zero outside. Now, this is another visualization. It was done at the University of Maryland. And you see the vortex lattice from the side. So what happened is that they managed to trap particles, solid hydrogen snowballs, size about a micron. They were trapped into the vortex lines. And so many, many dots along each line means a vortex lattice seen from the side rather than the top. Okay. So then the next question is, how do we make our system, our superfluid or our condensate? I use the two words as synonymous, although there is a subtle difference. How can we make this kind of system turbulent? Actually, it's very easy. Let me show you, for example, how it can be done. So So this is a numerical simulation which models very well an experiment in a quantitative way. What you see here is a rotating box. There are hard boundary conditions at the side. So we're looking at the system in the rotating frame, and periodic boundary conditions top to bottom. So the box is rotating. There is a finite number of vortices making a lattice, which you see here. But some heat flow was actually applied from the bottom to the top to try to destabilize the vortex lattice. And you see indeed that it succeeds. You will see that this flow, which is nothing but a flow of the normal fluid along the superfluid vortices, can make the vortices unstable, developing Kelvin waves. You see them forming already. Kelvin waves are these deviations of a vortex line away from its rest position, straight rest position. You will see that the waves grow in amplitude, and at some point, the amplitude of the waves becomes of the order of the separation between the vortices, a vortex reconnection takes place, and everything becomes very turbulent. And if you watch, I suggest that you keep an eye on what happens. Keep an eye to this vortex line, because from this side you see it better, and you will see actually the first reconnection happening there. Okay, so now the system is turbulent. Actually, it's polarized because we are in rotation. So it's some kind of polarized turbulence, as it can be measured numerically or experimentally. It has its own property. So this is what I refer to as quantum turbulence. It's a disordered system of vortex lines, of quantized vortex lines. Let me stress, what you see here is nothing but the axis of the vortex lines. So, but don't forget that around each line which you see, there is actually flow, which rotates about, like the classical 1 over r dependence, no more, no less. Okay, and the flow must be very complex because of the geometrical configuration of the lines. The vorticity, as I said, is zero because the velocity is actually always the gradient of a phase. So this system represents essentially potential flow with these defects. And so it's conceptually quite simple. But there are other ways to create turbulence. So let me review them quickly. So as I said, in helium you can destabilize the lattice, but you can also agitate the system like you would make water or air turbulent. You can use propellers, grids, forks, wires, tiny objects. You can inject vortex rings, which is easily done. You can apply a heat flow. In atomic condensate, you can do similar things. You can shake your system. You can actually try to stir it. How do you stir it? Well, you can't use propellers, but you can actually create what is called a laser spoon. So this is an example. So we see in yellow, in red actually, we see a condensate. Essentially, it's very flat, almost two-dimensional here. So red is high density, yellow is low density. And this blue cone represents a laser beam, which is our spoon, and we just rotate it, stirring the condensate, and we can produce a vortex. Here it is. So this experiment was done in Paris. So that's a standard technique. On the left-hand side, there is a mechanical stir. This is propellers, actually two counter-rotating propellers creating some kind of von Karman flow. And that experiment was quite famous. It was done again in Paris by tabling, creating turbulent liquid helium. The size of the box here was about 12 centimeters, I think. So there are various, many ways. In general, it's easy to create turbulence because the system is very fragile in a sense. The perfect state without vortices is very fragile. So it's never difficult to create turbulence. In fact, quite intense turbulent systems have been produced. So here you see pictures of a very big turbulent system. This is like a larger von Karman apparatus. This is in Grenoble, Schreck. And here there is some kind of superfluid wind tunnel, and the turbulence can be studied. One can actually study, for example, the energy spectra. So the energy, which is this, the integral of V square, can be decomposed over the magnitude of the wave number after Fourier transforming. I could say this is like a way of writing the energy summing over Fermi shells. And the classical Kolmogorov scaling would be that the energy spectrum scales like the wave number to minus 5 divided by 3. And that is very neatly, beautifully made visible in this experiment done by Julien Salort, who is here. So regimes have been achieved in which the turbulence of liquid helium or superfluid helium seems to reproduce some important properties of ordinary turbulence. Okay, that's a very good question. So in these experiments, actually, helium is actually in a two fluid state. I think the lowest temperature Schreck can go to must be above 1.6, because the immense cooling power which would be required. At 1.6 Kelvin, there is a perhaps 50% or more fraction of normal fluid. So we have together two fluids. Like in the Landau picture, we have a superfluid, which is what I'm particularly interested. But there is also normal fluid fraction, which is a viscous fluid. And the two fluids actually are coupled. Why are they coupled? Well, the normal fluid actually, as I said, it's a viscous fluid. It consists of a combination of excited states which are terminally excited. Yeah. So think of them as plane waves, as phonons. There are more objects than phonons. There are also rotons at these temperatures. So these excitations actually, like sound waves, become scattered by the vortex lines. So the excitations interact with the vortex lines. So there is a coupling between the superfluid and the normal fluid via the vortex lines. So it's possible that the energy of the vortex lines, the kinetic energy around the vortex, around one or many vortex lines, becomes transferred by this coupling, which is referred to as mutual friction, because it can act as a friction in both ways. And essentially, we transfer energy from the superfluid into the normal fluid. The normal fluid is viscous, so then viscosity will actually destroy your kinetic energy. So that is one example of dissipation. So it would be a bit like classical dissipation. It's a viscosity in the normal fluid component, which dumps the energy into heat. Now, the normal fluid component, however, can, as I said, can range in importance immensely. In fact, let's go back to this picture. If we are near the lambda point, almost the entire fluid system is normal. When we are at the lowest temperature of Schreck, we are here. So then there is a good question about what happens when we go definitely below 1 Kelvin, so about here. I remember at 1.4 Kelvin, there is only 4% of the normal fluid, which is of the helium, which is normal. So there things become different. There is still a mechanism of energy dissipation, but you need to be careful. When your system becomes almost essentially a pure superfluid, it does conserve energy. So the question becomes quite crucial. Is there dissipation? Yes, there is dissipation, because as vortices move, particularly as vortices accelerate, not move, accelerate, they radiate sound waves, and that is actually a classical effect. And this radiation of sound waves is the dissipation mechanism. So below 1 Kelvin, the sink of kinetic energy which exists in the system is acoustic. You're turning kinetic energy of the vortices into sound waves. Sound waves means phonons, quantized sound waves, and the phonons means heat. So you can create heat this way. And so in other words, if you start with a sample of liquid helium and you prepare it by phase imprinting is a technique which can be used in atomic condensates to put in vortices. Yeah, they can engineer the phase so as that vortices are printed in. And then you let the system go, the vortices will activate, interact with each other, produce turbulence, but they have to create sound because they move. And this sound essentially will become heat. So your temperature will rise a bit, okay? Is it clear? So there is always dissipation. So don't think that we escape dissipation by using a quantum fluid. It's not the case. Okay, so now let's turn to how we can describe these systems. And one model which is often used is the following. It is called the Gross-Peterski equation. So let me stress, this is a quantitative model of atomic condensates at low temperatures. It works extremely well, can be used to predict phenomena, but it is only a qualitative model of liquid helium. And the reason is how the equation is derived. So this equation, for example, can be derived starting from n-body quantum mechanics and making some approximations. So the operators become essentially expectation values. So we approximate psi from an operator becomes a classical field. And the interaction between the bosons has been simplified. Essentially, it's assumed to be like a delta, like a hard spheres colliding. And the interaction integral reduces to this cubic nonlinearity. So this equation is nothing but Schrödinger's equation, we recognize it, with a cubic nonlinearity. It's also called, in the mathematical literature, the nonlinear Schrödinger equation. Now the last term here, this V times psi, I put it there because if we are dealing with atomic condensates, you need to keep them together because here we're assuming that the bosons interact, so they repel. So you need to confine them, otherwise they will expand out. So this is the so-called trapping potential, which is some harmonic potential typically, or a box trap, if you prefer. So this is the description, and it is, if you want, the weakness of this model, if you're interested in liquid helium, is actually this. It does not contain, it simplifies the interactions. Liquid helium is a liquid. It's not a dilute gas, which is the model describes. Okay, here you see the normalization condition of the wave function. So various parameters, you see Planck's constant, the mass of the bosons. Sometimes the bosons is two atoms for helium-3, for example, which is a fermionic superfluid. We have a Cooper's pair, so it's two atoms. Two atoms of helium-3 and here, this coefficient G contains the scattering cross-section between the bosons. So this is the model. Now, the Gross-Peterski equation has a neat fluid dynamics interpretation, which is the following. Actually, it dates back a long time. It was invented, this transformation was invented by somebody called Madelung, more or less at the times when Schrödinger was developing Schrödinger's equation. So how does it go? We start from the wave function. As I said, we can always write it in this fashion with some amplitude, which is the square root of the number density. And then we have the exponential of the phase, amplitude and phase being functions of position and time. So if you substitute into the Gross-Peterski equation, which is an equation for a complex quantity, then you get two real equations. And here they are. The first equation is an equation for the density, the mass density, which is the mass of the boson times the number density. And it is nothing but the continuity equation, which guarantees the conservation of mass. So it's a classical continuity equation. The second equation, which I've written in index notation, so J equal 1, 2, and 3, is written here. So you see that this is Euler's equation, the classical Euler equation. So we have the acceleration of a fluid particle, and then we have this pressure gradient. But then there is also an extra term, and that's the difference between our system and the classical system. So what is the pressure and what is the extra term? Well, the pressure is quite simple. It's nothing but the density square. So we have a barotropic fluid. The quantum stress is more subtle. It's this expression here. Notice that this is the only place where you see Planck's constant. So it really makes our system different from the Euler equation. Okay. However, we can take limits. So we can take limits. We can actually define a characteristic length from our equation if we balance this term, which contains the nonlinearity, it's the coupling between the bosons, the term with g, and this term. Now, this term minus the Laplacian is actually the kinetic energy, it comes from the kinetic energy operator in quantum mechanics. So essentially, we're balancing interaction energy and kinetic energy. And look for the length scale at which the two are similar in magnitude. And this is the length scale, it's xi. What I identified as the vortex core parameter. You see again, it's Planck's constant divided by this expression. This would be like a chemical potential. So one can show that when the length scales are larger than this healing length size, then the quantum stress term, which is this, the cube term, becomes negligible compared to the other one. So all these quantum effects disappear, and really we are left with the compressible Euler equation. Okay? The system reduces to the classical system.
But Carlo, I don't understand this expression because you said that the flow was potential.
Yes?
So
and
you are showing Euler equation which has strong vorticity.
Yeah, the flow is potential. In writing this, that is assumed, in fact. In writing the left-hand side of the equation like this, there is something which is assumed, which is immediately visible from the definition. Yes, in the other slide, V is the must be the gradient of the phase. Yeah. That does not say. The Euler equation, but this is what it is. In this case, it must be zero. It must be zero, okay?
This is the way you work this equation. You have added a term and subtracted another one that you put in the quantum stress.
No, I don't think so. No. I'm simply taking the limit of Planck's constant going to zero, I'm looking at length scale larger than this, and then this drops out compared to that, and I have the classical Euler equation. Okay? That can have vorticity or not. Okay, we're still free to choose then the Euler equation with vorticity or without vorticity. Well, in our case, we need to be careful because it's a bit subtle. If you are still have quantum vortices, you don't have vorticity, but you have circulation because you can have topological defects carrying a circulation. Okay. Not convinced?
It should be a Bernoulli type of equation.
Yes, but using the fact that the vorticity is zero, you can actually rewrite it in this fashion, yes. Indeed, it's often written also as a Bernoulli kind of equation, time-dependent Bernoulli equation, correct? So this is one limit, and it's important to stress that it is compressible Euler equation because this is, if you want, a difficulty which is unavoidable in the problem. The vortex is like a very strong nonlinear wave. The density must drop to zero. So this is actually what is meant. So we are describing a system so as that there are vortices, which are these intense waves, the density drops to zero, and that allows the phase to change 2 pi around. But there are also weak waves, very small ripples, if you want, on the profile of the density, And there are also things in between the linear waves and the vortices, there are other strong and less strong waves. There are solitons. So in 1D particularly, or 2D also, and 3D. So there can be intense density waves which carry also some phase jumps, some phase difference between one side of the wave and the other side of the wave, more or less intense. So this is what is described by the Gross-Peterski equation, vortices and waves. Indeed, when people study turbulence, sometimes they study simply the turbulence of waves. It's quite the field at the moment, because wave turbulence theory, for example, was applied to the waves produced in a box trap atomic Bose-Einstein condensate in Cambridge, and they got very good agreement in terms of the properties of the turbulence with the wave turbulence theory. But in some cases, particularly if you're interested in the Kolmogorov spectrum, in aspects, if you want a strong turbulence, what you want to know is the vortices, and you tend to ignore these waves. So that is often the case with liquid helium. The people who study turbulence in liquid helium, quantum turbulence, tend to forget about the existence of these waves. And just the attention goes to the vortices. Now, there is another thing which is important to notice. The first thing to notice is that this transformation, the Madelung transformation, is actually sometimes problematic because it's actually singular mapping. So when we solve the system, when we solve the system and look for solution, we always solve the Gross-Peterski equation, not these Euler-like equations. And the second is that there are phenomena which are in the Gross-Peterski equation, which are not in the Euler equation. That's why actually the Gross-Peterski equation is interesting. So the most important are vortex nucleation and vortex reconnection. If you have the Euler equation and you want to study vortices and you don't start with vortices, then you're stuck because you cannot create a vortex. The creation of a vortex is a viscous mechanism. So you need something else. You need the initial condition to provide vortices for free. Gross-Peterski can do that for you, can nucleate vortices. And this is a numerical solution of the Gross-Peterski equation, which describes precisely what is done in some experiments in liquid helium. So what you see here is actually a little sphere, which in the experiments is an electron bubble. It's an electron which has been injected into the liquid helium. Its zero-point motion curves the bubble. The size is about 10, 20 angstroms. And the bubble is accelerated by a given electric field until it reaches a critical velocity, at which point, from the equator of the sphere of the bubble, a quantum vortex is peeled off and detaches. So we have created vorticity. Okay? And this creation crucially depends on this term. So then things become interesting. The vortex detaches, then it slides to the side, becomes some kind of handle, like see, like this, and then it grows, and you end up with a vortex ring with attached the electron. And in fact, the dynamics is taken over by the vortex ring and becomes quite funny because the electron is a particle, so if you give it more energy, it goes faster. But the vortex ring is not a particle. If you give it more energy, it goes slower. So when people did early experiments on something like this in the 60s, at some point they got horribly stuck. They were injecting electrons. They were trying to measure with time of flight techniques to measure how long it would take to go from A to B. And the charges which they were injecting would never arrive at B. And so they started thinking, well, there's something wrong in my experiment because it's very hard to give up on the conservation of charge. And then one of the experimenters who was a smoker, remember that you can make smoke rings, and the speed of a vortex ring actually decreases if you make the ring larger. That is what's happening. So once you have a ring with the attached ion, this object moves very slowly, and therefore you have to wait a long time on the other side of the apparatus before it arrives. So be patient. When things don't go right, be patient. So vortex nucleation, as I said, can be provided by the equation. So it describes this reality. There is another reality which is described by Gross-Piteyevsky, and it is vortex reconnection. So reconnections are phenomena in which two vortices collide. And in doing that, they exchange, if you want, heads and tails, like in this cartoon. So we have a red vortex. It's this line oriented. There is a flow around it oriented this way. There is blue vortex. And there is a collision. Then we end up with a change of the topology of the configuration and two lines, half red, half blue. So this process does not exist in the Euler equation because the Euler equation, there is conservation of helicity. And helicity can be related to the linking number. So that means if you have two vortices being linked like this, you cannot undo them. And you see actually why it cannot happen, because these vortices would have diverging velocity field on the axis, so you don't know what happens when actually the axes collide even. Now the vortex reconnections are quite interesting at the moment because there have been experiments in which they've been visualized, individual reconnections have been visualized. So this was done in Maryland, for example, and you see this visualization with the hydrogen snowballs tracers. You see these dots. Join the dots in your mind, and you have two vortices, and the vortices come together, and then they reconnect. And recently, reconnections have been seen also in atomic Bose-Einstein condensates, and that is quite even more remarkable, because in this case, the tracers are actually much bigger than the vortex core, so they disturb the vortices in some sense. But here, it was direct visualization of the system, so we can see individual reconnections. Now, let me stress that the reconnections are key to dissipation. So here, in this numerical calculation, you see a vortex and a vortex oriented in the opposite direction, so a vortex-antivortex pair approaching each other, computation being done in the periodic domain here. So these vortices are slightly bent. They're approaching. So they reconnect. So this is the reconnecting solution of the Gross-Piteyevsky equation found in the late 90s by Koplik first. So we have a reconnection, and then the vortices move away after the reconnection. You see the two cusps, which move very quick and move away. Now, if you plot the density on the plane, which is in between the vortices, which you see here. So here in orange, you see the density, and in blue, still the vortex lines. You see this, this kind of curved, intense density wave, or better, rarefaction wave. The vortex itself, remember, is a hole. A hole, there is no density. There is vanishing density on the axis, but there is also this reconnection cusp. It's an intense sound wave, which is actually beamed away to infinity. So reconnections means acoustic emission of energy. The vortices lose energy, and we create sound. So this is valid, and it's particularly important at low temperature, when the normal fluid with its own viscosity cannot provide a sink of energy. There is another way of describing vortex lines. If you're looking at length scales, which are much larger than the vortex core, then the vortex lines of the Gross-Piteyevsky equation become actually thin mathematical lines. So imagine this is a vortex of Gross-Piteyevsky, which we've seen in previous picture. I called psi the thickness of this tube, this Keeling length, this balance between kinetic energy and interaction energy. It turns out that in liquid helium, this size is actually 10 to the minus 10 meters. That's the order of magnitude. That's quite small. It's about the size of an atom. In fact, you may ask me, oh, well, but then at that limit, what about atoms? Aren't you neglecting atoms?
No, I'm not. Remember, we have actually, we don't have atoms any longer. We have a Bose-Einstein condensate, okay? We have a wave function. So our system is actually more continuous than a classical system would be, because at that scale, a classical system stops being a continuum, because you meet atoms. Well, our atoms are lost. We have a wave function with all of them. So 10 to minus 10. 10 to minus 10 meters is a very short distance. So it's not difficult to think of length scales which are larger than that. In fact, in typical helium experiments, the distance between vortices is something like 10 to minus 4, 10 to minus 5 meters. So at least 10,000 times bigger than the thickness of the vortex lines. Then the Euler equation can be manipulated. We can think of concentrated vortex lines, very concentrated. Our lines, vortex lines, become truly filament. So space curves, which I call vector S, parameterized by time and arc length. And one can derive the equation of motion, which looks like this, a throwaway term, which is smaller. So let's look at this expression. We see ds dt, so the velocity of the portion of the position of the line, S, is equal to what? Equal to Vs. What's Vs? Vs is the velocity at the point S induced by the rest of the vortex or other vortices. And that is recovered by solving the Bose-Einstein integral. Okay? In the same way as you get a magnetic field given by a current, so in fluid dynamics you get the velocity of a vortex, of a concentrated vortex, from the configuration for the distribution of vorticity, which is a delta function. So the vorticity, if you want, being a delta function, can be written as kappa times delta, and then this volume integral becomes a line integral. So we have the Bose-Einstein law, and then we have extra terms parameterized by this alpha, which is a friction coefficient. So that term describes the interaction between the vortex and the normal fluid. Vn is the velocity of the normal fluid at that point S. So this is the model. It's a very practical model, very useful for liquid helium. But notice, in this model, our vortex actually is a filament. We have lost any information about the core. So the reconnections don't exist. We have to do them by hand. If we solve this model numerically, we discretize vortex lines Lagrangian fashion, putting discretization points along the lines. And when lines collide, we rely on what we know from the Gross-Pitesque equation, and we do the connections by hand, algorithmically. So let's consider turbulence again. If you do these kind of simulations, either Gross-Pitesque or vortex filament, you end up with this intense system of vortex lines inside your computational box. In fact, if you make it very intense, it's all black. And then you wonder, what's that? So you follow what people do in fluid dynamics, compute the energy spectrum, for example, so the distribution of the energy is a function of the wave number, and in many regimes, you indeed find the Kolmogorov scaling, k to the minus 5/3, which extends to about this wave number corresponding to the typical distance between the vortex lines, which is very short in that picture, okay? If you try to go and see what happens to further larger wave numbers, you see that the energy spectrum becomes more shallow, becomes like k to the minus 1, because that is the spectrum of a single vortex. So you come so close to a vortex, you're looking at very short scales, you see the next vortex in front of you, and you feel that velocity field, and all the rest can be ignored. So the question is, well, first of all, why there is this classical Kolmogorov spectrum? So what's inside the vortex tangle? To make sense of that, you need to use all the information available, which this picture does not actually show you. What is the orientation of the vortices? So a way to do it is to coarse-grain the vorticity, or better, to coarse-grain the lines and create a vorticity, a superfluid vorticity, which microscopically does not exist, because the vorticity, the curl of the gradient of the phase must be equal to zero. So we invent a superfluid vorticity field, and we can do it in various ways. I think this is the best. So essentially, we put some kind of Gaussian of width, which is larger than the average separation between vortices, and essentially maintains the unit vector along the vortex lines, creating some kind of smooth shape. And we can apply this coarse graining to some test cases to see what happens, which is shown in this cartoon. So here we have two vortices which are actually anti-parallel to each other. And if we do the coarse grain vorticity, we find that it is basically zero. This grayish is very close to zero. Indeed, a vortex and an antivortex close to each other don't produce any large scale flow at all. The reason it's not exactly zero is to make it visible in this picture and to show actually what's the reality. So the lines will never be perfectly straight in general. There will be some deformations. And here there are some wiggles, yeah, very short Kelvin waves of small amplitude. And they actually cause this color gray different from exactly equal zero. Now, the second case corresponds to two vortices which are parallel. So the rotation of the superfluid is consistent, vortex one and vortex two. So if you keep two vortices very close, you end up with essentially twice, with two quanta of circulation. So a strong velocity field around your double vortex system, and therefore you create a vorticity, which is represented here. Okay. So if you do that, indeed you create a vorticity field, a superfluid vorticity field. Remember, you have done it simply by blurring your vision. You don't see the individual vortices, you see vaguely the net effect of many vortices. But it works, because if you look at the spectrum of this vorticity field, you get the K⅓ scaling, which is, again, classical in the regime in which there is the Kolmogorov scaling. So classical, when there is the Kolmogorov scaling, the vorticity increases with wind number with this slope. So this is actually the origin of the Kolmogorov spectrum. Here it's shown in another drawing. So we have a snapshot of a vortex tangle in this periodic domain. And all the vortex lines have been colored according to the macroscopic coarse grain vorticity. So where the vorticity is large, the color which has been used is yellow. Where the vorticity is small, it's reddish. So what you see is something like this. Now you can actually split this figure in two parts. In this bottom part, you put all the red lines. So the lines which don't contain vorticity. Essentially, they are placed with respect to other lines randomly. In the top part, we see only the yellow lines, the lines which are close to lines which are parallel. Okay? So these yellow lines essentially are bundles. Bundles of lines which the dynamics has brought together in parallel. Now that is actually quite remarkable, because when you make two vortex lines in an empty universe to come close to each other, they would actually tend to become antiparallel in order to conserve energy. So here, what you see that the Euler dynamics achieves in bringing parallel lines together, creating regions of higher velocity, therefore higher energy. Indeed, if you look at the energy spectrum and you compute separately the spectrum of this, the spectrum of that, and also the spectrum of the total, you see this nice transition. So the total velocity field produced by all red and yellow lines is the Kolmogorov spectrum. The contribution of the red lines is actually this K to the minus one spectrum. It's the yellow lines which actually contribute to the total spectrum. So it's the bundles. The bundles, of course, make the Kolmogorov spectrum, because being parallel vortices create large-scale motion with much energy. If the vortices, like you see in this cartoon, here there are four vortices, are not parallel, but are two up, two down, so the velocity field is it's quite complicated, because it alternates positive and negative vortices. There is not much net velocity, and the energy is nothing but the square of that. So there is not much energy. I stress that these bundles of yellow vortices are metastable. They are formed by the dynamics, but they don't stay there. They break up and form again. First thing. Second thing, most of the vortices, in terms of length, are red, not yellow. So most of the vortices represent dissipation, incoherent motion. It's the fine structure produced by solving the Euler equation, if you want. So, in conclusion, it's possible to reproduce numerically, imitating the experiments, regimes in which the turbulence behaves classically, but notice, only at length scales larger than the average separation between the vortices, which I called little L, curly L. So, we have a turbulent velocity field, we can look at the statistics of the velocity, yes? Why? Well, because, let's go back to this. Because in 1998, this great man made this experiment. He measured the spectrum. Of course, it was a measurement, so it was not a spectrum in K, but it was in frequency. And he published a paper in which there were spectra at three temperatures. Above TC, so above the phase transition of Bose-Einstein condensation, so liquid helium 1, which is a classical fluid, and the helium was made turbulent by the propellers, and there was a beautiful Kolmogorov spectrum. There was another line on the graph, and it was in helium 2, so it was a superfluid at relative high temperature, and it was the same spectrum. And then there was a third line at much lower temperature, 1.4 Kelvin. So most of the system was actually superfluid, and the spectrum was exactly the same. So everybody wondered, how is that? That the energy spectrum is temperature independent, even when there are quantum vortices, even when there are only quantum vortices. So there is an expectation which comes from the experiment. And I must say that before the experiment, nobody thought of spectra in the context of liquid helium, because we know too little for dynamics. So please ask questions and teach me things, because I need to learn. Sorry, say again.
So why do you get the third in the numerical simulation?
Yeah.
And why do you associate a minus one to a single vortex?
Oh, because if you take a single vortex and you can calculate the spectrum, you get minus one behavior.
But what is the meaning of the spectrum? Meaning the fully transformed of what?
Of the velocity field of your vortex.
So the velocity field, so that's the amplitude square of the fully transformed of
the it's velocity square, yeah. So the Kolmogorov spectrum comes from the existence of coherent bundles of vortex lines. If you have only random lines, but we're going to see this again more, you don't get Kolmogorov. But first, before we go to that point, let me tell you about the velocity statistics, because it reinforces what we know. Here, I'm not talking about the increments of the velocity, be careful, just the velocity components themselves. And in classical turbulence, they are Gaussian. I think there was this paper done long ago which showed it very clearly. However, in liquid helium, the velocity components are not Gaussian. That was a surprise. It was measured by Latrop at Maryland in 2008. And we did in Newcastle lots of numerical simulations of various systems in 3D and 2D using vortex filament and also using the Gross-Piechowski equation. And indeed, we agreed very well. Velocity statistics are power laws. So what's the difference between power law and Gaussian? Well, you know what I mean. It becomes apparent if you plot them log-log or log-linear. But then we actually found that the result which you get depends on the length scale at which you measure such velocities. So what you see in these two figures is actually the velocity field computed, integrated over regions of measurements which are larger than the typical distance between vortices, yeah, or smaller than the typical distance between vortices. So measuring the velocity at the point means looking at this picture. And you see this, the Gaussian, which is actually a very bad fit to the data, and the power laws.
Just one point.
Yeah, just one point. It's velocity components only. Yeah.
And you could blame the different scales.
You compare the different scales. So here we.
So
no. Now this is the point, the velocity at the point. So there is no coarse grain. The coarse grain is done, if you want, in the analysis, by considering either, by considering not the velocity at points in space, but rather velocity integrated over a little volume. All measurements actually involve integrating over a little volume. In Lathrop's experiment, the velocities were actually obtained by using tracers of size 1 micron, which is, in his experiment, it was less than actually the separation between the vortices. So he was essentially looking at velocities computed at points in between vortices. So if that is the case, you see power loss. Only when actually you integrate over a region containing many vortices, you get Gaussian. And there is a beautiful paper by Tony Leonard written in the 80s showing exactly this, that if you have vortex lines, the technical details are the following. Because of the extreme localization of the vorticity into delta functions, then you cannot apply the central limit theorem, and surprisingly, the velocity statistics will be different from classical. And it was a worry he had, because at that time he was developing essentially vortex methods for fluid dynamics. He was worried about that. Yes? So, correct. There are all sorts of. The in the experiment, the temperature is relatively high. There are difficulties. There are all these considerations. Okay. Okay. Anyhow, we have actually a smooth transition from power laws, which are the microscopic results of quantum vortices, to Gaussian, which takes place at the length scale corresponding to the intervortex spacing. Okay. When you blur your vision, you see classical. And conceptually, the same experiment, so that was done 2011. In Prague, Lamantia did the same experiment together with Ladig-Skrebek. And it gave exactly the same result, but in the experiment, rather than integrating in space like we did, they integrated in time using particle tracking. So. Yes, sure, it depends on the number of vortices, because little l depends on how many vortices you have per unit volume. Okay. So if you, again, the thing to remember is this. If you, microscopically, you have some strange behavior, because you have individual delta functions. But when you blur the delta functions, you see classical results. Okay, something else I want to say. A good question is, then, what happens when actually the temperature is very, 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 very reduced? So you've seen in these movies, which I've shown you, the vortex is becoming wiggly. But the movie was actually calculated, it was a calculation, which agreed very well with experiments, at finite temperature, so there was a bit of damping. If you reduce the temperature below 1 Kelvin, there is very little damping left. So you still get the Kolmogorov spectrum if you actually manage to inject energy at large. At large length scales. But the Kelvin waves can become very, very short. So a few years ago, people realized that actually there is another way for the, there was another route for the energy to go. So at some length scales, which are larger than the distance between the vortices, we have this Kolmogorov scenario, which is classical. But at some point, you have individual vortices. And it's the energy eventually will go there, flowing down K space, and will be transferred to individual vortices. And the nonlinear interactions between the Kelvin waves will produce Kelvin waves which are shorter. So the idea of the Kelvin wave cascade was born. And it was actually tackled using, again, wave turbulence theory. So there were predictions for a spectrum for a second cascade, which actually comes after the Kolmogorov cascade, provided the temperatures are low enough. And this paper by Leone and Brachet showed it beautifully. So here, so this was a big calculation because it had enough case space to see the Kolmogorov scaling at the length scales larger than the vortex separation, and then go inside further and look at the wiggles on individual vortices. So there is a second cascade, which is called the Kelvin cascade. And there was a big controversy about the prediction for the actual slope of this cascade. So there were conflicting predictions. They were solved brilliantly, eventually, and now there is an agreed result, which confirms the theory by Viktor Vov and Sergei Nazarenko. And this work was done by Giorgio Kustulovic. So now we know that there should be this cascade down there. However, the cascade has not been observed in experiments. Nobody has measured spectra at such extreme low temperatures. And there is another interesting prediction, of course, that the two cascades don't smooth jointly, because essentially the Kelvin cascade is not very efficient. So the energy flows down the Kolmogorov cascade and gets stuck with some wave numbers, creating some kind of bottleneck plateau, which you see here, before flowing down the Kelvin cascade. Now, what happens if you go shorter and shorter? Well, eventually we reach the scale psi, which is the ultimate scale. It's the healing length. So at that scale, vortices radiate sound immensely. So and all your energy will become phonons. Yes? It is zero. It's assumed to be zero. But we have enough resolution to go and look at a very, very high K.
So what is the equivalent?
Oh, that would be the dissipation, the usual dissipation.
That's a dissipation?
No. It's but there is a dissipation of it's kinetic energy dissipation. Energy flows down the cascade and goes down this way and eventually phonons. Yeah? So it's remember, total energy is fixed, but it can become phonons, sound waves. Right, move quickly to this. But there is another form of turbulence which has been revealed by many studies, experimental and numerical. It's referred to sometimes as Wien turbulence, after Joe Wien. So actually, the evidence starts being quite rich. That's why it's worth considering. So we have lots of helium experiments, mainly done in Manchester by injecting vortex ring and creating turbulence. Helium-3 experiments done in Lancaster, the simulations of those experiments which we have done in Newcastle, simulations also of counterflow experiments at high temperature when the heat flux is small, seem to produce the same kind of turbulence, simulations of thermal quench of a Bose gas. That's the fundamental problem. You take your bosons and you cool them. Well, you get a system which is a superfluid. You create a condensate, but it's going to be full of defects. So you have turbulence by definition, and how which kind of turbulence is it? Simulation of turbulence in atomic gases, that's an industry which is booming now, and even simulations of dark matter. So they all point to another form of turbulence, which is different. So it lacks a Kolmogorov cascade. The typical energy spectra look like this. So you see that, first of all, most of the energy is not at the smallest available wave numbers. So the energy curve does not go up. There is a deficit which is of a factor of 100 or 1,000 or more. Secondly, there is no Kolmogorov scaling. You see, rather, the k minus 1 scaling of individual vortices. So the peak is at the mesoscale. The mesoscales means the typical vortex separation. Other signatures are the decay of the vortex length, which is for Kolmogorov scaling, for Kolmogorov turbulence, the length will decay in time in this fashion, corresponding to this decay of the energy. And for the second kind of turbulence, the Wien turbulence, is different. It is actually minus 1 rather than minus 3 over 2, corresponding to a different decay of the energy, and also the velocity correlation. So we look at the velocity correlation to try to find out what it means. And the velocity correlations are very, essentially vanish very quickly. So what's interpretation of this turbulence, this Wien turbulence, it is a turbulence without a cascade. It's really a random-like flow, making a beautiful step backwards, because I suppose that when Reynolds thought of turbulence in his experiments, perhaps invented the Reynolds decomposition, I don't know, but he assumed that the fluctuations are truly random. So, violent turbulence has a random flow. And you see, for example, in the case of small heat fluxes, we produce turbulence. The normal fluid is still laminar, and we have indeed this kind of spectrum. But we need to be careful. This is only true at small heat fluxes. If the heat flux is large, then the normal fluid may become turbulent itself. Okay, so then we get actually quickly into hot waters, because we have two turbulent fluids rather than one. Let me say something about this case, which is physically quite important, the quench of a Bose gas. So when you go through a phase transition, you create order. But the order will not actually set up immediately everywhere. You end up having domains. So if you're trying to grow a crystal, you see that, yeah. Essentially, the defects of this, in our case, for the phase, correspond to vortices. So in creating a condensate, we go through a phase of turbulence. And this turbulence is a violent turbulence. It's a turbulence without a cascade, which obeys the same signatures. In a typical atomic Bose-Einstein condensate, the turbulence looks like this. Typical experiments, you see a blob of cold gas in blue, in pale blue. In violet, you see the vortex lines. There are not many lines. There are not many length scales here. And although the system is chaotic, and perhaps we say turbulent, there are not possible, really, to excite Kolmogorov spectrum. You lack a k-space. And indeed, in typical experiments, atomic physicists like cigars, for some reasons, you get all the signatures of Vinon's turbulence in terms of energy spectrum, decay of energy, decay of length, and correlation functions. And this is the last thing I want to say about the applications to astrophysics. This is quite fancy. So this is something which perhaps does not exist. But some people think there are axions. So the early universe had a superfluid of axions. And you end up with a nice equation, which is fantastic. It's a self-gravitating Gauss-Peterski equation, self-gravitating. And it produces turbulence, and it's Vinon turbulence, as they recognized in the paper. Right, I don't have no time to tell you about 2D quantum turbulence, which is quite a field. I just finished telling you that there seem to be three kinds of quantum turbulence. There is a classical-like, Kolmogorov-like turbulence, which gives the same velocity statistics and energy spectrum of the classical turbulence at non-zero temperature, or even at zero temperature, in which case we cannot escape the fact that perhaps we reached the simplification, the utter simplification of classical turbulence. We reduce the problem to a skeleton, its skeleton, which is these vortex filaments, which produce the same results. So I like to think of this as the skeleton of classical turbulence. And it has an added extra fancy feature, the K-UK cascade. So there is a second cascade attached to Kolmogorov. There is this kind of turbulence, which we see a lot in atomic gases and in other systems, which is a turbulence without a cascade. It's nothing but a random flow for various reasons. And there is also this case of counterflow turbulence at large heat fluxes, in which we have two fluids, normal fluid and superfluid, both turbulent. And that is actually a very complicated turbulence. Hopefully Lamantia will tell us about that. It's very complicated because it reminds me very much of the dynamos we heard yesterday. So we have a magnetic field, which can be complicated and turbulent, like in the Kármán dynamo, and the velocity field. And they're both nonlinearly coupled. So it's quite a problem. So, and all this requires much better thinking than what I sketched here. And hopefully the input of people who seriously know fluid dynamics like you. So I hope you put your brains and think of this. Thank you very much. Well, yeah, there are occasional, some papers try to look at, to go beyond the Kolmogorov. I think you need to. No, okay. There is one. Perhaps we need to ask the same question to Julian. When we did in this case, yeah. So this is a kind of decent Kolmogorov spectrum. That's the best we can get. Okay. So notice, not much k-space. Yeah? So we actually played with simulating exactly the experiments done in Manchester. So they were actually done, some experiments are done by injecting vortex rings from the same side of a cubic cell. Okay? So if you do that, to create turbulence of this kind, which has these properties, you need to transfer energy from high k, corresponding to the small vortex rings you are injecting, to large k. So there is no large-scale stirrer like a big propeller. So in that case, we examined carefully the energy flux, and we saw it building up. So we saw the energy flux being negative, so reverse cascading, because we had a system which was very anisotropic. Yeah, we inject from the left. Also, there is another way to put it. Recently, a few years ago, there was a paper by Toschi, Musacchio, Biferale, showing that the inverse cascade in 3D arises from the interaction of helical modes of the same sign. So they did what they called dissipation in k-space. So in experiments in which you inject rings, you do the same, because you have vortex rings which come from one direction, so they all polarize like this, like screws, and they collide, because some is big, some is small, so they have different speeds. They collide, and they are helical modes of the same sign, screws of the same polarity. And then we measured actually the flux, and we saw it's negative in the right regime, and we saw this building up. So I think that's the only numerical paper in which actually the flux was examined to look for where it is positive, where it is negative. So there is forward cascade and inverse cascade clearly defined until there was this build up. But in many other papers, well, I'm not aware of any other numerical paper in which that was done. And about the experiments, in some papers, quantities were examined with more care. I think I just let Julien to describe perhaps the Which slide was that? Sorry, which slide?
Ah, 2D.
Yeah, okay. There are more experiments done in 2D than 3D, I must say, with experiments with cold gases. So it's actually, for some reasons, they seem to be done, most of them, in the southern hemisphere. Okay. So typically you have like a flattened condensate. So the thickness of the gas is actually of the order of the healing length, the size of the cores. So we have point vortices. And here you see an example. This is actually a calculation done in Newcastle, but there was an experiment done exactly the same, because we just used experimental parameters. By Shin in Korea. So typically what you can do, for example, put a laser stirrer, a laser beam, which punches a hole in the condensate and move it, like you see here. You create positive and negative vortices, which are the dots. So you create a system of positive and negative vortices. Then you have 2D turbulence, quantized to 2D turbulence. Now, that is, of course, quite interesting in geophysical applications, but in the context of having quantum vortices, there is actually a beautiful theory by Onsage. It's called the Onsage vortex gas. And he showed the following, which I want to explain because it's quite neat. So you can actually describe 2D point vortices with a Hamiltonian in x and y phase space, which is simply, so P and Q are the x and y coordinates. So the phase space actually is limited. You're confined. So the number of given, the number of possible states for a given energy is a function which does not grow forever, but actually reaches a maximum and then comes down. So then there is a possibility of having negative absolute temperature. That is actually where this curve, oh, there is a blackboard here. So the log of the available states versus the states, okay, it's a curve which is like this. So when you reach this point, you have an infinite temperature from the point of view of the definition of thermodynamics, statistical mechanics. And then in this regime, you have negative absolute temperature, which means essentially very, very hot, and the vortices will cluster, producing this effect. And there have been experiments, and they beautifully showed this, this condensation a la Onsage. So you can think of that as the inverse cascade in 2D or the Onsage negative absolute temperature. So it's something done recently, as I said, mainly in Australia and New Zealand. So they're very beautiful experiments, and they look at the properties in equilibrium, but also when it is dissipated.